I picked up this keyboard at the thrift store a while back, and I just put it on the shelf and forgot about it, but I figured I might as well take it out and actually see if it even works. I only paid $1.99 for it, so even if it doesn't work, I won't complain. It is a Focus KeyPro from, I'm guessing, the early 90s. It was a competitor to the Northgate OmniKey and the Gateway AnyKey, which were also large keyboards with extra function keys on the side as well as on the top, which could be programmed to do macros. So in the days of DOS programs, which were largely keyboard based, you could assign one function key to execute a series of keystrokes, which was certainly very helpful and saved time. And this one even has a couple other extra keys like diagonal arrows, a turbo button, which I assume makes the arrow keys work even faster. And most unusually, it has a built-in calculator with its own liquid crystal display up here. You get a switch to go between regular keyboard number pad and calculator number pad. It does use clicky mechanical key switches. Not sure exactly which type. Except for these keys which have the indicator lights in them, those are not clicky. It's due to the space in the key switch mechanism that the indicator light takes up. That's why they couldn't put the part in there that makes it click, because it's the space where it's taken up by the little LED that has the indicator light in it. It comes with a function key template for WordStar 4.0, which is a little unusual to see, because back in the day, WordStar was largely based on control keys instead of using the function keys. I actually used WordStar back in elementary school on a Tandy 1000 to do book reports and things like that. And I still remember many of the command keys it used. For example, to make text bold, you did Control P and then B. And to save a file, it was Control K and then S. So it was based largely on control keys and not so much on function keys like WordPerfect for DOS was. But evidently it did have all the function keys assigned for those who preferred to use them, like to save a file, I guess it was F9, and to find and replace, it's showing red, so that would have been Control F2. You can see they're color-coded. Black is just normal pushing the button. Green is Shift, red is Control, and blue is Alt. I don't know how well those colors are showing up on the camera. But the shift is green, control is red, and alt is blue. And the function key template tilts, which is a nice feature. And of course, you can slide this out and put different things in. I didn't even notice it came with different things here. Let's see. There is DBase 4, which is popular database software for DOS. Microsoft Word version 5 for DOS. On this side is Lotus 1.2.3, release 3.1. Here's a blank one, and on the flip side is for the programmable function keys. Notice these say PF instead of regular F, because these are programmable. And finally, this has probably the most well-known DOS word processor of all time, WordPerfect 5.1, which was used in the legal industry until quite recently. It was only a couple of years ago that some law firms finally switched from WordPerfect to Microsoft Word. And on the other side of that is another blank function key template. So it's nice that it came with all these in there. I didn't expect that. On the bottom, of course, it has flip-up feet if you want to elevate the rear of it. Also has little rubber cushions if you just want to have it laying right on the desk. There's the data plate with the FCC ID made in Taiwan. Made by Focus Electronic Company Limited. It is model number FK-9000. Some kind of lock and open thing there. I don't know what that's for. Let's see. What could this be for? Okay, I got that open. Let's see. Okay, I don't know what that's all about. Some kind of knockout plug. And there's another one on this side. Oh, there's a battery in there. I guess that's for the calculator. I don't know what that one is for. Maybe you can plug in a little piezo beeper or something. I don't know. Interesting. But I definitely should get that battery out of there because it has a little bit of acid on it. That's actually a Varta NiCad 3.6 volt rechargeable battery. So I guess the idea is when the computer is on, the calculator is powered by the keyboard interface, but it has this battery here which lets you use the calculator even when the computer is off, which is a nice idea. For testing, I have it hooked up to this IBM PS2 model 5746 SLC2. This computer will need some restoration work, so it'll be the subject of a future video. But for now, it's good enough for testing. I have one of these adapters hooked up, which lets me connect the AT-style keyboard connector to the PS2 keyboard port. So, turn on our monitor here. And turn on the computer. And the keyboard lights are on. And it's beeping. So that's not a good sign. But let's try again. Now it's saying 301. Last time it was 303. And this display is not showing anything legible. Just random characters. Oh, there it works. Some of the digits are not responding, but the calculator seems like it's trying to do something there. Well, it's working better than last time, so maybe the third time will be the charm. It has 301 again. Alright, just to make sure that the PS2 wasn't causing the problem, I pulled out my old 6x86 system, which has a real 5-pin AT keyboard connector on the back, so no need for a PS2 adapter. And same problem, keyboard error or no keyboard present, and the little LEDs are stuck on. There's the keyboard disassembled. You just remove four screws across the top. You unplug this cable for the LCD, and then the top comes off. I discovered that it actually has an XT-AT switch, but that was in the AT position, so that's not the problem. Except maybe if that has dirty contacts, so I'm going to try putting it back and forth a couple times and give it one last try, see if that might have possibly been a problem. I doubt it, though. And then you can see a little bit of the controller. It's a Toshiba controller. Although it also says Intel. Toshiba TMP-80C50. It says Focus on there and then also Intel. Here's the top part of that battery. Some corrosion on the contacts, but not too bad. A little bit of sandpaper will take that off. There's the bottom of the mechanism. When I was maneuvering it around, it broke off one of these wires. So I'll need to re-solder that back onto the battery connector. There is a date code there. That looks like 82, but I think it's just a 92 with a little bit too much ink on it. So it's probably February 2nd, 1992. And there's your close-up view of the key switch. It uses an Alps mechanical key switch. Nice and clicky. And then we just pop the keycap back on. And there you go. Except these are not clicky, as I mentioned earlier. Okay, I got the battery wire reconnected using my typically poor soldering skills. And for now, I'm just going to put this thing back together. Even though it doesn't work. Maybe at some point I'll try replacing the few capacitors that are on the board, because I know in some other keyboards the capacitors can go bad and cause it to not work after so many years. So that might be the problem with this one too. Now when disassembling or reassembling a keyboard, it's a good idea to lay it down on a soft surface so you don't end up scratching the keys. So now we just have to put in those four screws that were holding it on the top. On the bottom here, there were four clips, I think I actually broke one of them. I think I broke that one, but oh well, the keyboard is not working anyway, so it doesn't make much of a difference. At least I only paid $2 for it, so it's not too bad for a dead keyboard. And there's the Focus Keyboard's competitor, the Gateway 2000 AnyKey keyboard, which was standard equipment on Gateway computers from the early and mid-1990s. You can see it's basically the same layout as the Focus keyboard, including these strange diagonal arrow keys, except that it does not have the built-in calculator. These keys are used for programming the macros. And it also uses rubber dome key switches, so you do not get that clicky sound and feel as the Focus keyboard has. So, it's still pretty good by the standards of rubber dome keyboards, but it's nowhere near the same feeling as the clicky key switches. Also, for some reason, it has two backslash keys, one up here by the backspace key and one down here between the alternate and control keys. Do not know why that is. The Gateway keyboard was also made in 1992. It was manufactured by MaxiSwitch in Mexico. And this one actually works, so I guess you can count that as one more advantage over the Focus keyboard.